Our call to worship today comes from Psalm 145, and I'm reading the first five verses. Hear the word of God. I will extol you, my God, the King. I will praise your name forever and ever. Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty. And I will meditate on your wonderful works. Were those words not so beautiful coming from God's word to us through the psalmist? So come, let us praise the Lord in song as we join together in proclaiming and giving God all the honor and glory. Let us join together in singing, How Great Thou Art.
O Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
A very good morning to each and every one. I greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and I wish to welcome you to our service today. Although it be online, we are all together in spirit. How wonderful is that not, that through the Holy Spirit we can be together. May I ask how you are doing? Are you still coping in our current situation? I'm sure that if you have been journeying with God, you have got through it quite okay. As we gather today, before we get started, just an announcement. Please take note that we are in Thanksgiving month, which is November. This is where we come and we give thanks to God in monetary value for everything that He has done for us. Remember, in the old days, they used to refer to it as the harvest festival, and we used to bring in parts of the harvest to bring that to Almighty God, to the church, so that that could help the church operate. Today, or in Joburg, shall I say, we don't have all those farms around us, and we don't have a harvest festival. That is why we set apart the November month, and we call that the Thanksgiving month, where we express our gratitude to God. And of course, as part of the Thanksgiving month, where we give that little bit extra to the church, we will also be doing a Thanksgiving concert. And please write down this date, the 25th of November at 6 o'clock for 7 o'clock the evening, yeah, at the church. And you may say to me, John, what is a Thanksgiving concert? Can I tell you, briefly summed, it's where we are going to gather as God's people, as God's church, and we are just going to have a wonderful time together. We're going to have fun together. We're going to sing, and we are going to share a meal together. So please, I want to invite you, please come and join us. The tickets are on sale. They're in the church office available, and the tickets are 20 rand per person. Now, really, what can you buy with 20 rand? Not very much. So I ask you, please come and support us, and let us come and have fun together. As part of that, we also request that you bring a plate of eats with, and then from 6 o'clock to 7 o'clock, we will share in that meal, whereafter we will go into our concert. Now, it's not a professional thing, but it is all of us, some of us, yeah, in the congregation, who believe we have a little bit of talent that God has given us. We have joined together in putting a band and a cast of singers together. And we, as the congregation, members of our congregation, are going to entertain the rest of you in the congregation. Come and join us. It really, really is going to be a wonderful time. So, let us continue. Let us come to do what we came to do, and that is to hear the scriptures, to hear God's message to us today, and also for those of us who are receiving the service with the music, then we are going to sing to God and praise Him in song. Our first lesson today comes from the book of Haggai, and I'm reading chapter 2 and the first 9 verses. On the 21st day of the 7th month, the word of the Lord came through the prophet Haggai. Speak to Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, to Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest, and to the remnant of the people. Ask them, who of you is left who saw this house in its former glory? How does it look to you now? Does it not seem to you like nothing? But now be strong, Zerubbabel, declares the Lord. Be strong, Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest. Be strong, all you people of the land, declares the Lord. And work, for I am with you, declares the Lord Almighty. This is what I covenanted with you when you came out of Egypt, and my spirit remains among you. Do not fear. This is what the Lord Almighty says. In a little while, I will once more shake the heavens and the earth, the sea and the dry land. I will shake all nations, and what is desired by all nations will come, and I will fill this house with glory, says the Lord Almighty. The silver is mine, and the gold is mine, declares the Lord Almighty. The glory of this present house will be greater than the glory of the former house, says the Almighty. And in this place I will grant peace, declares the Lord Almighty. You know, there's one thing in life that really worries me, and that is how people can think they can live their life without God, without Jesus, without the Holy Spirit. Because my life is in God Almighty. So let us praise Him in song, and let us sing, "My life is in You, Lord." Please join me as we come before the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. O dear Lord God, our Heavenly Father, in you created us in love and came to us as a babe born in a barn. In your love, you welcome us as your children. In your love, you lead us faithfully day in and day out. And with your mercy, you hear our prayers. We praise and thank you, Lord. So this morning, Lord, we pray that you will hear us, your beloved children, as we come before you in praise and worship. O dear Lord Jesus, our Redeemer, you have come to save the world and to save us. You call us to follow you. You teach us the truth in our troubles. And you offer us our peace, your peace, that can be surpassed by nothing. O Lord Jesus, we pray today that you will meet with us, your beloved brothers and sisters and friends, as we come to hear your word to us. And O Holy Spirit, living one, in the beginning you breathed life into chaos and darkness. You brought hope, and on one starry night you brought good news that a Savior was born. On one early morning, you defeated death forever. So, Holy Spirit, speak to us, your people, wherever we are, and whoever we are. O dear Lord God, loving Father, Son, and Spirit, we come. Yet we know we come with doubts and fears, and we know we come in ignorance, and we know we have failed you, your creation, and your people in many ways. Trusting in your love, we turn again to you, as we open our hearts to your mercy and forgiveness. Grant us today your peace. O Lord Jesus, please forgive us. Heal us deep within, so that we love and trust you more deeply day by day. Dear Lord God, as we've come today, speak to us through our hearts and our minds, that we may absorb what you give to us. And Lord, as I bring your message to these your people, I pray, Spirit, as beautiful as you are, that you will take control of me, and that every word and message that flows from my mouth will be yours, and that they will bring you honor and glory at all times. So, Lord God, we pray, accept these prayers. Accept our worship, accept us through your love shown to us, given to us in Jesus Christ, who came, who is with us, and who will come again. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our second lesson comes from Paul's letter, the second letter to the church in Thessalonica. Therefore, 2 Thessalonians. And I'm reading verses chapter 2 from verses 1 to 5 and then 13 to 17. I just repeat the reading. It's 2 Thessalonians 2 verses 1 to 5 and 13 to 17. Hear the word of God. Concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered to him, we ask you, brothers and sisters, not to become easily unsettled or alarmed by the teaching allegedly from us, whether by a prophecy or by word of mouth or by letter, asserting that the day of the Lord has already come. Don't let anyone deceive you in any way, for that day will not come until the rebellion occurs and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the man doomed to destruction. He will oppose and will exalt himself over everything that is called God or is worshipped, so that he sets himself up in God's temple, proclaiming himself to be God. Don't you remember that when I was with you, I used to tell you these things? But we ought to always thank God for you, brothers and sisters loved by the Lord, because God chose you as first fruits to be saved through the sanctifying work of the Spirit and through belief in the truth. He called you to this through our gospel, that you might share in the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. So then, brothers and sisters, stand firm and hold fast to the teachings we passed on to you, whether by word of mouth or by letter. May our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word. Thanks be to God for his holy word today. As we prepare ourselves to receive the message, let us worshipfully praise the Lord in song as we join together in singing, "As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after thee."
As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you.
You alone.
You.
My friend, and you are my brother, even though you are a king.
You're my friend, and you are my brother, even though you are a king. I love you more than any other, so much more than any.
The deer pants for the water.
Folks, something I want to share with you today is a new question that has been popping up in my travels around the community and working with people. And the question that was posed to me is, John, we're in a new world, a new South Africa. We have new technology. The world has progressed considerably from the time of the Bible. So then, how relevant is Christianity in a modern day society? Now, when you think of it, and it sounds maybe like an argument, but you know, there's one thing we need to understand, is that even if times change, even as we change and we modernize, nothing can be so modern that supersedes God. Nothing. Because we must remember the progress we make with technology, the progress we make in the way we live, all comes from God. It is God who gives the human being the ability to create this technology. But what I want to say to you is, although the world is changing, although we are changing, God will always be with us. And God never changes. As I was doing my preparation for this, and the term God is with us, it just reminded me of that wonderful song, Emmanuel, which means God is with us. Now, in this modern day environment that we find ourselves, although, I repeat, although everything is changing, because I do believe if you go and you look at what happened in biblical times, in the way they had to do things, just take transport for example, they didn't have cars, they didn't have motorbikes. They were either on the back of a donkey or on a camel or by foot. Nowadays, we climb on a jet plane and we fly from here to Singapore in 9 hours and we're there. So, although everything changes, God never changes. It also brings to mind the other song. Yesterday, today, forever, Jesus is the same. And although people come and they make accusations and they say, we're in a faith that is ancient, or we're in a faith that is old, we must stand strong. We must be bold and we must continue working. We must continue working for Jesus in proclaiming his gospel to the nations out there, to everybody out there. No matter how old-fashioned it seems, it's not. Because even in our modern-day situation, we will find that the scriptures are still very relevant. And we must be strong. Because one of the main oppositions we have in why people are staying away from churches is technology. If we take a look at our youth, for example, they are so caught up in computer games, TV games, that they don't even spend a lot of time with parents, with family, or with friends anymore. They are continually behind a computer screen or a TV screen, and they are trying to win this game. So folks, we have to stand strong. We have to proclaim God's word to the people out there, because what the world does not seem to know or seem to realize is that even in this modernity, it is going to come to an end sooner or later. So as I said to a person the other day, there's only one thing in life that is guaranteed, and that is our death. So what happens if we do not praise and worship the same God, this God that is with us. What is going to happen when our life comes to an end? Because our technology, our modernity is not relevant in God's world out there in heaven. And why do I say it's important to acknowledge that God is always still with us? Because it is God who gives us the wisdom. It is God who gives us the guidance. It is God who gives us the strength and the perseverance to fight the good fight in a modern day world. Another point I want to raise in today's message is that we must always praise God. We must praise Him for His power. We must praise Him for His faithfulness. And we must praise Him for His greatness. Because our God is awesome. Our God is great. Our God is all-powerful. It's easy to say we worship a God that is almighty. But we somehow seem to mix up modern-day terms with biblical terms. Let's take this, the one term I used, that we must praise God for His power. Now, when we go and we look at the meaning of the term power in a secular society, that would mean a person who is all-powerful, a person who can do what he wants to, a person whose power is sometimes measured by monetary wealth, a person who has a way to become tyrannical, to become an oppressor. We just look through the world, how many of those have not been around? I think one we all remember very well was Idi Amin up in Africa. What an oppressor and tyrant he was. We look at Hitler. We look at all these people. How oppressive and how powerful they were. But in Scripture, power takes a different meaning. A totally different meaning. Can you remember about a year ago, on one of these online services, I taught you the term sub contraria speci. Sub contraria speci. And the meaning of this is that in Jesus' weakness, He found strength. So, what does that mean? It means that when Jesus died, now when somebody dies, we believe you're in your weakest. When Jesus hung on the cross, before He died and when He died, people of the world would see Him as weak. Is it not the nature's law that says it is survival of the strongest and the fittest? And yet you have a man nailed to the cross, surely that cannot be strong. Well, what people don't realize is that it was in that weakness when God or Jesus died, He went into the depths of the earth to go and conquer sin and death. Remember, by rising again on the Sunday, He conquered death. By going into the depths of the earth, He conquered sin. Because it was in the depths of the earth, as it is described, that He took control of sin, of evil. And that is why many a time when I pray, I proclaim that Jesus has authority over both good and bad. So you see, understand, sub contraria speci means in His weakness, He was strong. So to be able to conquer death, He had to be strong. But at no time At no time in the life of Jesus, at no time in his death, in no time in his resurrection, was Jesus a tyrant or an oppressor. In actual fact, the scriptures say to us that if we wear the yoke of Jesus, it is a yoke of freedom, not one of oppression. But let us take a look just quickly at the life of Jesus. Was Jesus not always humble? He was. Never did he show his strength to the Sanhedrin or to the Pharisees. He responded in manners that portrayed humility, but also portrayed cleverness. Cleverness in what got the Sanhedrin and the Pharisees thinking. Thinking so much that they could not even answer some of his questions. When they asked him, Pilate said to him, "You've been accused of proclaiming to be the king of the Jews." Jesus didn't even acknowledge that. He didn't even acknowledge that he was the king of the Jews in front of Pilate. He did not. He did not show any power whatsoever, but he stayed humble until he died. Folks, that is what we are supposed to do. We are supposed to be humble. We are supposed to be the least, and we know that is what the scripture gives to us. And just as Jesus is faithful to us, we are to be faithful to Jesus. I know it's very difficult in a secular society, because when you are humble and you do not show any power, people are inclined to laugh at us. They're inclined to mock us. They're inclined to embarrass us. And yes, many a time we do want to express our anger. We do want to express the power we have. But you know, we don't need that. Because through love, through humility, it is just somehow how people start to love us. I mean, let's take a classic example of this. If you were to meet a person who was arrogant and portrayed his power and his strength, would you like such a person? No, you wouldn't. The first thing you would say when you walked away from him, "Oh, so-and-so is so arrogant." Or, "So-and-so thinks he knows everything and he thinks he's so powerful." And you wouldn't want anything to do with him. But have you noticed when you come into the company of somebody that is humble, somebody that is willing to listen to you, you always land up being a friend to that person. You have this eagerness of wanting to mix and have fellowship with such a person. Now, can you imagine if each and every one of us had to go out there and be humble and be the least? Would that not everybody want to be our friend? Would not everybody want to love us? Will not everybody want to mix with us and be in our company? Because we do not make them uneasy. Because they know, because we are humble, we will not be judgmental. Because we will receive them and accept them for who and what they are. They do not need to change. As part of my opening sentence on the second point, I said we need to praise God for his power, his faithfulness, and his greatness. Now, have you ever stopped to think? We sing that wonderful song, "How Great is Our God." Why do you sing that to him? What makes God great? What makes him praiseworthy? What makes him great in your eyes. I bet you it's not because he's almighty and that he impresses everybody with his power. No. I want to read to you once again from something that you all know so well. And that is the fruits of the Spirit. Do we all know them? Can we all remember them? It's from Galatians 5, verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit. Now remember, this is what happens when you allow the Holy Spirit to work through you. Then God's greatness manifests itself through us. The fruit of the Spirit is love. In other words, it's not a restrictive love, it's an unconditional love. It is joy. That's what I spoke about last week in church, and I apologize that we did not have the service online, but I said in church, we all seem to be so negative when we have this wonderful salvation and mercy. And here it says, if we have the Spirit within us, one of the spirits that flows from us is joy. We have peace. We exhibit that Jesus is ever present with us. The next fruit of the Spirit is forbearance. In other words, we tolerate things that we do not agree with. When people do things, when people say things that might hurt us, we tolerate that. Kindness. We are always kind, not seeking to oppress or suppress, but we always show kindness and goodness and faithfulness, not only to God and Jesus, but to one another as our church family. Gentleness. When we speak to somebody, are we gentle? Do we take cognizance? Remember, I've always said that whenever you say something, say it in a manner that does not offend anyone. The last one in the scriptures is self-control. In other words, God gives us that power to control ourselves the way the Spirit intends us to be. The last point I'm just going to touch on very briefly is to live a life of faith here, now, today. To exhibit our faith so people may see that Jesus is within us. I want to share with you, and I know you say, yeah, John, we've heard this before. And yes, but I want to share with you in this week that's gone by. I counseled a person that said to me, you know, John, I lived with my partner for 15 years. In those 15 years being together, I always used to say to her, don't worry, we will get married, we will have children, we will have a family. I was not interested in anybody else, but what I wanted to do is I wanted to pursue life, make a success of life, make money so that we could live luxury, that we could live easily. Does that sound familiar to you? I must first get money. I must first ensure that we can live. I must first ensure that we can do whatever we have to do. And we were together for 15 years. And I said to her, just hold on. We'll get there. And then she died. She contracted cancer and she passed away. It is 8 years later. And this person can still not start a relationship because he still can't seem to get over what he had lost out on with his original partner. He said to me, John, I have no children. And I can't have children because I'm going on in years I've missed out big time. Folks, don't let that happen to you. Last week in church, I sketched the scenario of if Jesus had to walk into the church, how would we respond? Of those responses, I said, are you going to respond in a manner that says, oh no, God, not now. Why did you have to come now? Or would you respond in a manner saying, if only I had given my life to Christ when I had the chance? Folks, are we going to live a life of regret if Jesus had to come? That is why I make the statement, and with this I end off. Live a life of faith, a faith that was given to you as a spiritual gift by Almighty God. Don't wait for someday, but do it now. Prevent heartache. Prevent the gnashing of teeth. Prevent the tears. And live a life of joy and happiness. Amen. Come, let us pray. Oh, dear Lord God, we have heard your word to us today, Lord. We have heard your teaching. We have heard your warning. Lord, as we come before you today, we want to ask that you will help us. That we won't postpone, Lord, but that we'll accept you as our Lord and Savior today, Lord. That we will give you that prayer of asking for forgiveness and acknowledging that our Lord Jesus Christ is our Savior. Oh Lord, it is not that we don't believe to some of us, but it is this constant pursuit of success. Success in life, success in our families, success in our homes. And we know, Lord, that tomorrow is not guaranteed to anybody. And therefore, Lord, we want to ask you that you will just persuade us to do the right thing, and that is to come to you right away. Oh Lord, we know that if we don't, it may land up in tears, the gnashing of teeth, or extreme anxiety. And Lord, we also know that today is not too late either. If we have missed out in life, Lord, that we come to you and that you will give us a new life to live it the way you want us to live it. Oh Lord, we thank you that you are there for us 24/7, no matter what, and that you are always willing to help us. Thank you, Lord, for Jesus. Thank you for being a God, the God that you are. And thank you for everything that you do for us. So, Lord, we thank you, we praise you, in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. As we conclude our service today, let us profess our faith in our next song. As we sing, it's basically the Apostles' Creed in the song with the title, We Believe.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear. There is only one foundation. We believe in this broken generation. Dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations,
folks. Sadly, that brings us to the end of our service for today. It's been an honor and a privilege to share God's word with you. It's been an honor and a privilege just to have some time with you. I want to wish you well, and therefore receive now the blessing. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of His Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. May God journey with you. May you put your hand into God's hand and let Him take you through the next week. May your week be filled with God's richest blessings until we meet again. So, until we meet again, stay safe, stay healthy, and always remember that Jesus is only a prayer away. Goodbye now.